I'm Nick Pettit.
I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be going over a new proposed solution for web browsers for high-resolution images, new versions of Twitter Bootstrap, and the usual roundup of interesting JavaScript plugins. So let's go ahead and get started.
Believe it or not, the W3C is actually working on CSS 4.
I don't believe it.
You should believe it because it's happening. Basically, there's been a lot of high-resolution devices coming out from Apple, namely, there's the iPad,
iPhone,
and now the new Retina display MacBook Pros. And of course, there's lots of other device manufacturers coming out with high-resolution devices. And the W3C decided that the best way to deal with this would be with CSS. And fortunately, Safari and Chrome are now shipping this new proposed high-resolution image solution. It's available in Safari 6 and Chrome 21 in the form of the image set value that you apply to background images. So basically, you have a low resolution image or a normal resolution image, and then you have your high res version, and you have an additional value where you can kind of specify, you know, what resolution each one of those images is at.
This seems to be like a little bit better of a solution to me than the JavaScript plugins that we've been talking about. You know, I think it's really cool that they'll have it right in CSS rather than the kind of hacky stuff that we've been having to do with JavaScript. Not to demean those plugins at all, because they're wonderful.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I mean, going in and trying to detect with JavaScript seems a little bit messy, and it's nice to have a native built-in solution.
Although we are probably going to have to deal with detection for a long time.
For a little bit.
Next up, we've talked about Twitter Bootstrap in the past on this show, and version 2.1.0 has just been released. New in this version of Twitter Bootstrap is new documentations, something called the Affix plugin, which is going to let a little sidebar on your screen stay with you as you scroll. There's submenus on dropdowns, block buttons, new image styles, fluid grid offsets, a new nav bar, and this is pretty big. Increased font size and line height. So if you're interested in Bootstrap or you currently have Bootstrap, go ahead, check it out, and upgrade.
Pretty cool stuff. Now, speaking of Bootstrap, Dan Grossman has this really cool date range picker that's designed for, you guessed it, Twitter Bootstrap. Basically, he was working on Improvely, and he needed this date range picker, so he went ahead and created one. You have reservation dates here as one example, where you can kind of go ahead and select a start date and an end date, and it will apply them in real time. That's pretty cool. And then there's also predefined ranges. So you can pick things like today, yesterday, last 7 days, and it will go ahead and update those in real time. Now, this does require jQuery, or it relies on jQuery, but that's not really a huge deal. I think lots of sites include jQuery these days.
Yeah, something like 80% of the top websites include jQuery, and something like 90% of all the statistics I tell you are not true. Next up, you know what I really hate, Nick, is pressing buttons when I'm developing things, primarily the reload button. Isn't it such a drag to tap that or press Command R?
It is.
Well, I have wonderful news for you. There is a new plugin kind of system called Reload. So this uses Node.js, Grunt, and it works on Safari. When it does, it watches a certain directory for you. You tell it what files to watch. And as soon as one of those files changes, you know, CSS or JavaScript, it goes through and reloads your web browser for you. Boom, done. You can get back to the important stuff, like browsing the internet.
Browsing Reddit, Facebook,
yeah,
et cetera. That's really important.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. I remember there being, you know, similar features in lots of other, you know, frameworks and things. I know, like when you're working with SAS, you can go ahead and tell it to watch a directory or, you know, similar things like that. But
yeah,
this seems like a more generalized solution. Mm-hmm. So when you're developing HTML and CSS, it can go ahead and do that for you.
It's similar to a paid application called Live Reload, which does the same thing, SAS and CSS. And that one's actually pretty cool because if you modify CSS files in Live Reload, you don't even have to reload the page. That's why it's called live reload.
Wow.
Yeah, fancy.
Aptly named. Next up is BigVideo.js, and this is really cool. Basically, you can apply a background image to your website that is a giant video. It requires jQuery UI, and actually several other things, the VideoJS API, in order for it to work. And in my opinion, I think it's more of a novelty than anything else. I don't really see a legitimate use for this. I think it's kind of, I don't know. I guess if you had a video that was really, really subtle, maybe like, you know, a galaxy with star background and had like
a music video,
little twinkling lights, probably not a music video.
No, this would be awesome on my MySpace page.
Yeah, no, definitely.
A gigantic video of me in the background.
Yeah, I don't see a legit use for this, but nonetheless, it is really, really cool.
Well, next up, I'm just going to move on from there since we disagree pretty heavily on that.
Yep.
There is an introduction for new programmers to JavaScript called JavaScript for Cats. There's not really much to say about this, but it is a wonderful, wonderful and free introduction to the JavaScript programming languages, and it uses cats. So there's literally nothing not to like about this website. Go ahead, if you've got somebody who's interested in learning JavaScript, or if you want to learn JavaScript, take a look at jsforcats.com.
Now, Jason, I can't think of anywhere else that I might go to learn JavaScript.
Me neither.
Maybe other than teamtreehouse.com.
No, I don't think that's a thing.
Yeah, I think teamtreehouse.com is where you could learn JavaScript.
Pretty sure you just made that up.
Yep. Next up is underscores, which is it's not a WordPress theme, it's a starter theme, or it's a way to create themes for WordPress. So basically you go to underscores.me, and you go ahead and type in the name of your theme. So I'll call mine maybe the...
Call it Jason.
Treehouse theme, okay. I'll go ahead and call it Jason. And then you can go ahead and type in advanced options, such as your slug, the author URI, description, etc. And you hit generate. Now, this is not a WordPress theme, like I said. It's just a starter theme, but it has, you know, lots of well-commented HTML5 templates. It has a nice 404 template and lots of other cool CSS to go ahead and just get you started developing a WordPress theme.
That's really great because it can be kind of tedious to start developing your own WordPress theme, especially, you know, having to go and take a theme and modify it and get everything out of there that's, you know, already implemented.
Absolutely.
Next up, we have something called CDNJS.com. CDNJS is a CDN, or content delivery network, for hosting JavaScript libraries. Google CDN and Microsoft CDN already host JavaScript libraries for you. What this one does is host some of the less popular libraries for you to use in your application. There's a huge list of things that have a decent amount of followers and you'll probably be using in your apps. So if you are using a CDN, or if you're not using a CDN right now, go ahead and check out cdnjs.com. It's really easy to just throw that piece of JavaScript in your website and boom, done. Boom, done.
Boom.
Boom.
Boom. Next up is JustGage at justgage.com. Gage is spelled G-A-G-E. And JustGage is basically a JavaScript plugin that allows you to create nice, animated, clean-looking gauges. Now, we've seen this before, Jason.
That's true.
We've seen these gauges appear elsewhere. We've covered them in the past on the show.
Gauges are pretty hot right now.
They are. And, you know, we saw this new piece of JavaScript that allows you to create gauges, and we started talking about what legitimate uses for gauges might be.
We couldn't readily think of any, but we did come up with maybe using the login process to a website, start typing in your username, gauge starts to spike up about 50%, type in password, 75%.
or
sign in.
Maybe as you're scrolling down the page, a gauge could tell you how close you are to the bottom.
Or how fast you're scrolling.
Ooh, yeah. That's a good one. It'd be like a scroll speed limit or a speedometer.
Don't want to get a scrolling speeding ticket.
I hate those.
Yeah.
You could have the X and Y position of your mouse with gauges.
These are all legitimate uses.
That might be really nice.
Probably the best one, though, that we thought up was the gauge that starts at 100%. When you sign up for a dating website and slowly goes down as you fill out your profile and upload pictures.
Yeah, it's the more it learns about you,
the less it likes you.
The less it likes you. Actually, there is a lot of legitimate uses for gauges, but I think they're very specific use cases.
Yeah, we're being a little harsh.
One, a little bit. One in particular that I really like is on the Google Web Fonts directory. When you go to pick a font and you click on Quick Use, they have this really nice gauge over on the right side that tells you how that font might impact your page load time. So that's kind of nice. It's kind of, I guess, a different way of presenting quantitative information like
that. Yeah, maybe download sizes as you assemble a custom JavaScript library or framework.
Exactly.
Things like that.
So Jason, what did we learn today?
We learned that gauges are awesome.
And I think that I learned you can't do JavaScript without cats.
Pretty useful information.
Yeah, definitely.
I think we all learned something here today.
That is it for this week's episode. Please go ahead and follow us. I am at NickRP on Twitter.
I'm at JSeifer on Twitter.
Thank you so much for joining us, and we will see you next week.